So we have seen the word identities that follow from Virasoro symmetry. And these word identities are really the linear symmetry equations that are obeyed by correlation functions in the presence of this conformal symmetry. So we have written them in particular for correlation functions of primary fields, since you can deduce descendant fields from primary fields. Now, what happens if we have a degenerate field? So by definition, a degenerate field obeys additional equation because it has a vanishing null vector. So for example, we have a degenerate field V11, which is killed by L minus 1 because it has a null vector at level 1. So what happens if we have a correlation function with this degenerate field? Well, let's consider a three-point function. So we have seen, as a consequence of conformal symmetry, the three-point function is determined up to a proportionality coefficient. It is z1 minus z2, delta 3 minus delta 1 minus delta 2, z1 minus z3, delta 2 minus delta 1 minus delta 3, z2 minus z3, delta 1, minus delta 2, minus delta 3. So now, what happens if I replace the first field with V11? Well, V11 has a dimension delta 11 equals 0, so I have to put zeros instead of delta 1. So that's easy enough. But that's not all. In addition, we have this null vector, and by our fundamental axiom, L minus 1 acts as a derivative. So that's d by dz V11 is L minus 1 V11. So therefore, this three-point function should not depend on z1. So how to make it z1 independent? We need delta 2 to be equal to delta 3, so that these two factors disappear. Well, unless the three-point function is zero, of course, unless the proportionality factor is zero, but assuming it's non-zero, we need delta 2 equals delta 3. So that's an additional constraint, and essentially this field V11 behaves as an identity field, a field which does not modify the correlation function, because after we impose delta 2 equals delta 3, we are left with essentially V11 V delta 2 V delta 3 proportional to delta 2 delta 3, so the constraint that they are equal, times Z2 minus Z3. Well, minus delta 2 minus delta 3, which is the same as minus 2 delta 2. So we recover just the two-point function of V delta 2 and V delta 3. Okay, so this is, a relatively trivial case of a null vector equation. So I could call this equation d by dz V11 equals 0, a null vector equation. So now let's consider the next case where we have a null vector at level 2. So let's consider the field V21. And this field is killed by the combination L minus 1 squared plus B squared L minus 2. Well, in other words, 1 over B squared D squared by dz squared plus L minus 2 acting on V21 of z is 0. So now what happens if we insert this field in a correlation function? So let's have V21 of z1, V delta 2 of z2, V delta n of zn. Well, we have to compute L minus 2 acting on this field, V2,1, insert it into this correlation function, which we can do because that's what the local ward identities are for. They are for giving you the action of descendants on correlation function. I mean, the action of creation operators like L minus 2. And if you do that, you obtain an equation for this correlation function. That's 1 over b squared, d squared by d squared z1, plus sum for I equals 2 to n, delta I over z1 minus zi squared, plus 1 over z1 minus zi, d by dzi, acting on this endpoint function, is 0. So that's a partial differential equation of order 2. And this is called the Belyavin-Polyakov-Zamolodchikov equation. So if we had, instead of a degenerate field at level 2, if we had a field VRS, well, this one is killed by an operator LRS, which is L minus 1 to the power RS plus something. And therefore, we would obtain a partial differential equation of order R times S. So that we could also call that a BPZ equation of higher order. I mean, here we have a BPZ equation of order 2. So other questions up to now? So if no questions, let's discuss this BPZ equation in the case of a four-point function. Why a four-point function? Because thanks to global conformal symmetry, the four-point function reduces to a function of just one variable, one cross ratio. And therefore, we expect that the BPZ equation reduces to a differential equation instead of a partial differential equation. So, let's say we have a BPZ partial differential equation, and we take n equals 4. We use global conformal symmetry, and this should reduce to some ordinary differential equation, to an ordinary differential equation for a function of the cross ratio, or equivalently for, let's say, V21 of Z, V delta 1 of 0, V delta 2 of infinity, V delta 3 of 1. So there should be a differential equation, which I will shortly write. That's actually an exercise to derive this differential equation. It is not completely straightforward because we want to set the positions of these three fields to specific values. However, in the partial differential equation, in the BPZ partial differential equation, we have derivatives acting on the on these positions, and now we want to set them to fixed values. So it's a bit of a calculation, but the answer is 1 over b squared d squared over dz squared. Let me write it by having a factor here, z, 1 minus z, plus 2z minus 1 d by dz, plus delta 1 over z, plus delta 2 minus, no, it's the opposite, delta 2 1 minus delta 2, plus delta 3 over 1 minus z. So that's a differential equation, no, in just one variable, the variable z, for this four-point function. And well, again, it's again a linear equation. Again, it's not enough to compute this four-point function. I mean, we did some nonlinear constraints, and we will get them later from the conformal bootstrap. But we will study in particular this type of four-point functions. But before moving to this conformal bootstrap, I would like to do a digression about affine, abelian affine Lie algebras. But other questions? Yeah, so the question is what would happen if I, instead of a four-point function, I studied the BPZ equation for a three-point function. And you're right, I would find a constraint on the dimensions of this field, on the two fields, exactly like what happened for the first-order equation. So if I consider the BPZ equation for V21, V delta 2, V delta 3, well, I would get a constraint relating these dimensions, and that constraint is better written in terms of the momentums, P2 and P3, and this constraint is that if this three-point function does not vanish, P2 must be P3 plus or minus B over 2. So let's move to this abelian affine Lie algebras. And why do this digression? But, well, because so far we've talked only about the Virasoro algebra, but in many interesting confluent field theories, we have larger symmetry algebras, as we started to see this morning about the Vestumino-Witten models. And so I would like to give an idea of how this this formalism is generalized to larger symmetry algebras. And, well, I'm not as brave as Lorenz, so I won't embark on something as complicated as Vestumino-Witten models. Instead, I'm just talking about abelian affine Lie algebras, so a really simplified version of what he was doing. So, actually, it's almost the simplest symmetry algebra we could write. So, let me remind you that in this formalism, we can write, instead of writing the commutation relations of the Virasoro algebra, we can equivalently write the operator product expansion of the energy momentum tensor with itself. So that was C over 2 over Y minus Z fourth plus 2T of Z over Y minus Z squared plus derivative T of Z over Y minus Z plus order 1. And to define another algebra, I'm using just one current J, and I'm writing G of YG of Z equals minus 1/2 over Y minus Z squared plus order 1. So minus 1/2 is really a choice of normalization. I mean, I could rescale J and obtain any number there. On the other hand, the absence of first order pole, it follows from the arguments we have seen in the case of non-abelian algebras. I mean, due the commutativity of these two fields implies the vanishing of this first order pole. Okay, so instead of basing our theory on T, we could base it on this J, on this current. Now, are we still doing conformal field theory? Well, the answer is yes, otherwise I wouldn't talk about it, but it's not completely obvious. I mean, T has a good reason to be here. It originates from this Virasoro algebra, which encodes the action of conformal transformations. So, so I should find T somehow in my theory, even if I start with a current J. And actually, it's possible to construct T from J, and the way to do it is to write T equals minus JJ minus Q derivative of J. So here I have introduced a new concept, which is the normal ordered product. So I will shortly define this. I mean, because it's not obvious that I can take the product of these two fields at the same point. Actually, I can't literally do it because when they go close together, they have a second order pole. So I will have to do some regularization to define this product. Otherwise, I have also introduced a parameter q. So I have some freedom to introduce this parameter q, and actually any choice of q in the complex number q will give us some energy momentum tensor and therefore some Virasoro algebra. So it seems that we don't get just one Virasoro algebra, but we get an infinite family of Virasoro algebras, which is maybe a bit too much. But actually, only one of these algebras will really interest us. I mean, we have our fundamental axiom that the derivative with respect to Z of some field is given by the action of L minus 1 on this field. And this axiom will be true only for one specific choice of Q, and it will not be true for the other Virasoro algebras and the other modes L minus 1 that I could have. So out of this infinite family, only one Virasoro algebra will correspond to actually conformal symmetry, and the other Virasoro algebras will are, if you want, spurious. Okay, but then to prove that it is really a Virasoro algebra, so I have to recover this operator product expansion of T with itself from this operator product, but first of all to define this normal ordered product. Yes.
Is it good again? Can you say again why you write T equal to this dimensional analysis?
Yes. Well, indeed, dimensional analysis. Ask me why I write this formula, but you already suggest the answer. I mean, dimensional analysis is a good place to start because. From this formula from JJ, I know that J has dimension 1. I mean, if I'm assuming that the coordinate itself has dimension minus 1, then J has dimension 1. And T, well, from TT, I can see that T itself has dimension 2. So I have to write something of dimension 2 from a current of dimension 1. So the natural thing to do is to take either products or derivatives. And here I'm taking a linear combination of product and the derivative with some coefficient q. Well, actually, I could put an extra coefficient here, but here I'm anticipating that I need a specific coefficient in order to recover this particular operator product expansion. Okay. So now let's define this normal ordered product. Well, the definition is actually quite straightforward. JJ of y, let's say, is the limit when y JJ of z is the limit when y goes to z of j of y j of z plus I'm subtracting the singularity. Well, okay, it's an easy definition, but it's maybe not very general. It looks specific to my particular current, so let me write this definition in a more general form. So let's consider two fields, A and B, and let's assume they have some operator product expansion where I have a singular part. So now the singular part will be A of y, B of z, with this funny square bracket. And the rest is of order one. So here, in this particular P, the singular part is just this term. And in the operator product of T with itself, the singular part is, well, all that I have written here. Then the normal order product AB of Z is defined as the limit Y goes to Z of A of Y, B of Z, minus the singular part. In other words, this O of one term starts with the normal ordered product AB of Z, And then, well, I'm still neglecting terms, but now of higher order, of order y minus z. Okay, so that's the definition of the normal ordered product. Any questions on that? Well, I won't tell you why, but it agrees with the definition of the normal ordered product when you decompose these objects into modes. So when you have modes, typically you put creation modes on the left and annihilation modes on the right, and that's the normal ordered product. And that would agree with this definition. But here we are in a formalism where we don't write modes, basically. We just write operator product expansions. Okay, so now we have a definition, but can we compute with normal ordered products? And in particular, can we compute operator product expansions of, let's say, T with itself or T with J? And, well, that's not completely trivial. And to help us, there is a Vick's theorem, which tells us how to do it. So let's the theorem tells you that the singular part of the operator product between a field A and a normal ordered product BC is given by 1 over 2 pi I integral around y dx over x minus y. So we have a of z, b of x, singular part c of y, plus b of x, a of z, c of y, singular part here. So we could deduce that from the definition. Now the exercise is to use this Vick's theorem to actually compute the operator product expansion of T with itself. Well, we may not want to start directly with T with itself, but we could start with computing the operator product expansion of JJ of Y with J of Z. And if we did that using Vick's theorem, we would find minus J of Z, minus J of Y over Y minus Z squared plus order one, which is the same as Y goes to Z, the same as minus D by DZ Y of J of Z over Y minus Z plus order one. Okay, so indeed, I'm not giving you the steps of the calculation. I hope you can reproduce them if you're interested, but that's the result of using the Vick's theorem to compute this operator product expansion. Yes?
Is there a factorial of 2 or something in Vick's theorem? Is there 1 by 2 factorial?
So the question is whether I'm missing some factorial, you mean? In, the factorial could come from a symmetry factor. Well, actually, I don't think so. I think this formula is correct as written, although yeah, it could be checked. So let's take A equals identity. Well, for A equals identity, we would expect the result to be zero, right? Because the singular part of the operator product of the identity with something is zero. It would be a regular operator product expansion. And indeed, if A is identity, here that's zero and that's zero. So I think it works in this case, but probably that's not the way to detect a factor of two. Okay, So now if we accept that we have this operator product expansion, it's fairly straightforward to deduce the operator product expansion of T with J. And we would find minus Q over Y minus Z cube plus D by DZ J of Z over Y minus Z plus order one. And then after that, we should be able to compute T with itself. Okay, so again, I'm giving you the answer. So if we computed the operator product of T with itself, what would we find? So T of Y, T of Z. Well, I'm not rewriting it because essentially we would find this operator product expansion, except that we would find, of course, a specific value for the central charge. I mean, here everything depends on the parameter Q, so we would find that the central charge is given by, in terms of Q, by 1 plus 6 Q squared. So that's exactly the formula which we saw before when we introduced Q as another notation for the central charge, except that now it takes this formula takes another meaning because Q was not defined as another notation. It was defined as a parameter when writing the energy momentum tensor as a function of the current J. And yeah. So this shows that indeed we have a conformal symmetry, we have an energy momentum tensor, and we are doing conformal field theory when we are considering this affine abelian Lie algebra. So since we are doing conformal field theory, yes?
So may I ask, so I'm not sure I get the statement correct. So you're saying in any CFT I can define a field J which is not primary, but will help me. So is that field J in the theory itself, or is it some sort of auxiliary thing that I have to... The question is, does every spectrum of a CFT have such an operator?
Yeah, so your question is whether in any CFT I can have a field J. So in principle, the field J is not necessary because by definition, a CFT just has T, and if I can't write T in terms of J, no problem. It's still a CFT. In practice, you could say that okay, if you have T, maybe you can define J just by this equation. T equals minus JJ minus QDJ. You could take this as a definition of J. But if you do that in a CFT, typically your field J will not be single-valued. It will not be a meromorphic, which means that you don't have an affine abelian affine Lie algebra. It's not a symmetry of the theory. You don't have the corresponding Ward identities. So you could still consider it as a spectrum generating algebra if you want. If you have a Verma module, you can rewrite your Verma module as a module generated by the modes of this field J, but you won't get the corresponding Ward identities. That's all. And if you really insist in considering this field J, you will find that it has branch cuts and yeah, it's not very well behaved, although it can still be interesting. Yeah, actually, if you want, this is like constructing your CFT based on free fields. And this is the basis of a perturbative approach to conformal field theory. I mean, but it is a perturbative approach that gives exact results in two-dimensional CFT. It's called the Coulomb-Gass approach. And it allows you to compute some correlation functions. But since this approach originates in free field theory, you will have a constraint of conservation of momentum. So you will be able to compute only the correlation functions that in some way or another obey this constraint. Okay, other questions? Okay, then let's consider now primary fields. So we had primary fields for the Virasoro algebra, and we could define them as corresponding to the primary states via the state field correspondence, but we could also have defined primary fields by the operator product expansion with T. So T of YV delta of Z is delta over Y minus Z squared plus Y 1 over Y minus Z D by DZ V delta of Z plus order 1. So that's a primary field, or if you want, that's a Virasoro primary field. Now, if we have an abelian affine algebra, so if we have this current J, there is another natural definition of a primary field. So again, well, we can resort to dimensional analysis. So T has dimension 2, so it's normal that we start with a double pole here. Ah, I'm missing V delta of Z. But now J has dimension 1. So if I'm considering an operator product with some field V, it's natural to start with a simple pole. So for Y goes to Z, that would be something times my field, and let me write alpha, the coefficient here. So let me call it V alpha. So that's the definition of affine primary field. So now, in the same way as our question after defining J was whether we had an energy momentum tensor, now the question, when we have an affine primary field, is to say whether it is a Virasoro primary field as well. Again, there is a computation to be done using the Vick's theorem to compute the operator product of T with this field V alpha. And let me give the result, T of Y V alpha of Z is alpha q minus alpha over y minus z squared v alpha of z plus 1 over y minus z minus 2 j v alpha of z plus order 1. So here, this j v alpha is again a normal ordered product. So that's the result of the calculation. So now what is the interpretation? Well, the interpretation is that indeed this affine primary field is a Virasoro primary field, that it has the dimension delta of alpha equals alpha q minus alpha. And on top of that, we find that its derivative, dv alpha, is given by this expression, minus 2 jv alpha. So we find some extra equation here. Yes? Is it clear whether I can make this identification? At this stage, I would say it's not completely clear, but let's make it and see if we run into some inconsistency. Yes, another question? No.
Can you say why it's not clear why you expect it to be the case and why is it not
wrong? Well, okay. First, it obeys a dimensional analysis, but okay, that's. That's not a strong statement. Well, if you define the theory the way I did, it's clear that when you do this operator product expansion, there's no way to find directly the derivative. You must find here some residue which has to be built from whatever ingredients we have until now, and so it has to be something like that. So if you want the identification of this with a derivative is really where our axiom comes in. The axiom that L minus 1 acting on a field is the derivative of this field. So at some point, I mean, this axiom must give us some extra information, and this is the information it gives us in this case. Okay, so now we define the primary fields, or, well, affine primary fields, and solving our theory, well, solving free bosons, means computing the correlation functions of these affine primary fields. So my third lecture will culminate in solving free bosons, basically. So to do that, let's compute Ward identities. And to compute Ward identities, we'll proceed as we did in the case of conformal theory with the Virasoro algebra. We'll take our field J, our current J, and insert it into a correlation function of primary fields. So J of Y product of V alpha is EI. So we really want to compute the correlation function of primary fields, but we consider this auxiliary object. So this auxiliary object is determined by its poles, its residues, and its behavior at infinity. So the poles are simple enough. They are given by this operator product expansion. As for the behavior at infinity, well, I have to say how J behaves when Y goes to infinity. This so far is not given, but I have to choose this behavior such that T behaves as 1 over y to the fourth, if I want to be doing conformal field theory on the sphere. So it turns out that the correct assumption on J is that it should behave as q over y plus something of order 1 over y squared. So let's compute this n plus 1 point function. So given its poles, its residues, and the decrease of J at infinity, it has to be given by just sum I equals 1 to n, alpha I over y minus zi times the correlation function of primary fields, product v alpha I zi. Now, let's consider this behavior of J. So this it implies that this prefactor should also behave as q over y plus 1 over y squared. So this implies that sum of the alpha I must be q. Otherwise, the endpoint function has to vanish. So this correlation, this condition is called momentum conservation. So to rewrite the result, my endpoint function of primary field starts with a delta function of sum of the alpha I minus q. Okay, then, so that was, if you want, the global Ward identity. Then let's consider local Ward identities. So just as in the case of the Virasoro algebra, local Ward identities tell you how descendants are computed if you know how to compute primaries. And this will be particularly interesting because here we have an equation which relates a descendant with a derivative here. So because this JV alpha, if you consider the definition of the a normal ordered product is nothing but J minus 1 acting on V alpha, actually. So let's compute this J V alpha using this formula for this n plus 1 point function. So let's compute, well, rather, the insertion of JV alpha into the...
Clear.
Yes?
With a J minus 1, it's not so clear.
Yeah, right. So let's prove that. So J of Y... JV alpha of... JV alpha of Z is 1 over 2 pi I integral... J of Y, V alpha of Z. So that's the definition. Now, I have not defined J minus 1. That's probably the problem. So I have to define the modes of this current J. So Jn of, Jnv is defined as 1 over 2 pi I integral, so V of Z, sorry, integral around Z of dy, j of y, v of z, times a factor y minus z to the n. It should not be n, it should be plus 1. No, it should not be plus 1. Basically, I want to recover... Here I'm probably missing a factor of 1 y over z. I want to take the regular part, so the regular part is... Indeed, I'm missing this factor, I think. And then here I really need n. So I had n plus 1 in the case of the Virasoro algebra, but now I'm doing it for a field J of dimension minus 1. So I just need to have n here. And in this case, I think you recover this relation between this product and J minus 1 V alpha. Well, I had plus 2 in the converse formula.
Exactly, yes, correct.
But now I'm doing the integral formula, so I think it would be plus 1 in the energy momentum tensor. Yeah.
Yes, you had plus 1 in the integral.
Yeah, so now it's just n. I mean, this dyj is dimensionless. So basically, I want jn to have dimension minus n, and that's why I have here power n. Okay, so thank you for the help. So let's compute this, let's insert this GV alpha in this correlation function. So basically, I want to compute JV alpha of Z1, normal ordered, V alpha 2 of Z2, etc. So this is obtained by integrating around z1, dy y minus z1, j of y, v alpha of z1, etc. So now this auxiliary correlation function is given by this formula. So I just have to compute the integral of this prefactor. So I would find... I would find the sum for I equals 2 to n of alpha I over z1 minus zi times the endpoint function of primary fields. Okay, so now let me use this equation. So this equation relates this to dv alpha, except that there is a mistake in this equation. Now it's, let me add in red what's missing. There is an alpha factor, which should be there. So this alpha factor is again here. So if we take this alpha factor into account, we find d by dz1 plus some I different from 1 of 2 alpha 1 alpha I over Z1 minus Zi of this endpoint function, product V alpha I Zi, equals 0. So that's a consequence of equating this correlation function, equating this JV alpha with a derivative of V alpha. So this equation determines how this endpoint function depends on Z1. And we could get analogous equation for the dependence on all the variables Zi. And we can solve these equations. And the solution is that the product V alpha I Zi, well, we know already it starts with a delta function, some alpha I minus Q. And plus we have to solve these equations, and the solution is product for I less than J, Zi minus Zj, minus 2 alpha I alpha J. So up to some proportionality coefficient, to some constant coefficient. So therefore, we have computed these endpoint functions explicitly. Well, we have solved the free bosonic theory. So in a sense, this U1 affine, abelian affine symmetry is more powerful than the ordinary Virasoro algebra, because it completely determines the dependence of correlation functions on Z, without even assuming we have null vectors. So that's the end of this digression about abelian affine symmetry. And in the next lecture, we will start talking about the conformal bootstrap itself, crossing symmetry, conformal blocks.
May I ask?
Yes. Yes.
Q in particular. You found the relation between Q and the central charge?
Yes, we found the relation between Q and the central charge, yes.
And one thing that I didn't quite get is Q now fixed? What's the value? Is Q fixed by the L minus 1 on V condition is equal to V, or?
No, so you're asking if Q is fixed by this condition.
Yes.
So the answer is Q is a free parameter. I mean, you can start with any Q, but of course you will get a central charge depending on Q. If you are interested in a specific central charge, well, you have just two values of Q you can take depending on the central charge. So, other questions? Yes?
Is it possible in principle the affine primary fields might just not be Virasoro primaries? And this equation wouldn't be satisfied.
Yeah, is it possible in principle that the affine primaries are not Virasoro primaries? So the in this case, it's no longer possible now that we've proved that they are Virasoro primaries. But if instead of this abelian affine algebra, you invented some funny algebra, I don't think it would be guaranteed that you would get Virasoro primaries. You would have to prove it, certainly, and it might not happen, depending on the particular algebra you took and the particular definition for your primary field. Another question? Yeah, so you're asking about correlation functions of del phi. So basically, you're linking this formalism with other formalism based on the free boson. So this free boson you're alluding to, so let me put that in a corner. So the free boson phi you're alluding to is a field such that basically J equals d phi. So this this d phi is now J, and then V alpha, you would write it as e to the 2 alpha phi, actually. Well, normal ordered somehow, because apparently this does not make sense. So now, if you want to consider correlation functions of J, so indeed J, well, is it really a primary? Well, we have here somewhere the operator product of T with J here. And actually, it's not primary unless Q is zero. Anyway, whether or not it's primary, you may want to compute its correlation functions, but it's really not hard to compute correlation functions of J. Here we have a one-point function of J, and it's just given by this. And you can add any number of J's, and because you know the poles and residues, you will be able to compute them. So, no more questions? Yes? Yes, right. So, so the question was, is it related to vertex operators in bosonic strings? And indeed, yes, that's one way to build bosonic strings in flat space. You typically use three bosons. Well, you don't use just one, but several free bosons. And from this free boson phi, that's how you can build your vertex operators, which are indeed the primary fields. So the question is whether we have null vectors. I would say no, we don't have here null vectors. Okay, if there's no more questions, that's a good time for a break.